In the early 90s, a group of amazingly talented people had an idea for a show about nothing. And they turned it into a cultural phenomenon. I wondered, what would happen if a conservative Baptist pastor, who incidentally is a huge fan of the star of that show, decided to rip off his latest idea to edify his assembly? Kick back, relax, grab a Coke. Hop in and join the ride. Wildwood Baptist Church has some super cool Christians who will make you laugh, challenge your faith, and bless your life. It's Christians in cars getting Cokes. Episode 5, DR. This will be epic. Type of interior decorating style Dan Roth would go with, what would you say?
I would guess he would have a classic, minimal, no-nonsense, but fully functional aesthetic.
So are we talking like feng shui minimalist, like California minimalist?
No, nothing foofy like that.
So Dan strikes me as the kind of guy where, although he would be minimalist, I would be willing to bet you that some high dollar, high quality, uniquely positioned and specifically selected items would be thrown into the minimalism.
I think it would be something that is meaningful to him, you know, because I know he has some things that he's just passionate about.
Right.
Like coffee beans.
You know he doesn't have some, like, Keurig.
No.
He's got money invested in coffee, that is for sure.
We will not find any Folgers in that house.
No. He roasts his own beans. He cares so much about coffee that he just has figured out where to order them. He has bypassed the entire middleman process, and he does his own specific kind of roasting.
You know, I don't know if people know this, but he does roast the beans, and that's what we use at our cafe at church.
Yes, and of course he requires a handsome sum.
He does.
No, he does it for free.
Oh, that's fine.
Dan's almost not fun because it's fun to be mean, right? And, well, it is for me.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's fun to be mean, and it's hard to be mean to Dan because he serves the Lord so faithfully and does it without attention to himself and does it quietly. If you're not careful, you won't even know he's there. But yet, at the same time, he likes to have a good time and laugh and goof around. If we were going to have a laugh at DR's expense behind his back, which isn't very Christian.
No.
This isn't carnal Christians and cars getting Cokes. This is
spiritual Christians.
This is Christians. This is actual Christians getting, and cars getting Cokes. But let's pretend that we were carnal. And that we were going to have a laugh at DR behind his back. What would be the first thing that that comes to mind that we could have some fun at the Irish expense?
I would say his absolute loyalty to Windows, Microsoft Windows, anti-Apple. That's something that comes to mind.
The anti-Apple thing is one of the conspicuous weird things about Dan. It isn't just that he champions Microsoft. Mm-hmm. Understanding that it might very well end up being Microsoft that brings in the entire Antichrist microchip 666 system that represents all that is satanic and evil. The very gates of hell, if you will. Ba-doom, boom. The very gates of hell. And, you know, in a weird way, one of the most faithful servants of the Lord I know may very well be unwittingly bringing in Satan's entire system. He's an Apple hater.
Apple hater, yeah.
He's an Apple hater.
Maybe that's what's going to be the sign that when they can usher in unity between the Microsoft and the Apple crowds, then we'll know.
That is what the symbol is about, the forbidden fruit. Someone has taken a bite of the knowledge of good and evil. And when Bill Gates consumes Apple, Satan and the world will have come together.
Yeah, I'm sure that's how it's going
to
go down.
I think it is. I think that's pretty good. Something to make fun of about DR behind his back. Dan is kind of a grammar Nazi, isn't he?
Yes.
Yeah, Dan can be kind of a grammar Nazi. And I don't mean like a normal grammar Nazi, where, you know, some grammar Nazis are like they're helpful Nazis. Like they're Nazis that want better things for you.
Okay.
You know, Dan's version of grammar Nazism is not so much like I'm the friendly Nazi who wants you to be able to articulate and understand your native tongue in a way that you are better able to express yourself. It's more of a you're kind of stupid kind of a vibe.
Yeah.
What do you say?
I agree, now that you say it that way.
Yes, he has a disdain. I would say that his disdain for improper grammar is equal to his disdain for Apple. So, like, if you wanted to just really annoy Dan and put all of the things that bug him together into one package, you could be like, hey, Dan, do you like Apple? And he'd be like, yeah, I like apples. And then we could be like, well, Wildwood Baptist just bought another MacBook Pro. How do you like dim apples? And then dim apples is incorrect. I mean, that would
dem,
drive...
Yeah,
yeah, so it merges both.
It's not dim, it's dim.
Yeah, see, and he would be like, if you're going to use that joke, it would technically be, how do you like those apples?
We stand corrected. But what I think, okay, what Dan brings to our church, and I think this is what so many Baptist churches need, are people who will sit in the very front row.
Yes, and respond to the preaching. He does that.
He does that.
He laughs at my jokes.
Yeah.
He laughs at my jokes.
He does.
He shows up all the time. He sits in the front. He amens.
Yep.
He agrees. He responds. He remembers the sermons. Dan, I take back every negative thing I just said about you. I don't care about your grammar Nazi. You know what? You should be a grammar Nazi. People need to learn how to speak their own stinking language.
Absolutely.
Dan's a crusader.
Right there?
No, the American flag.
Oh, the American flag. Of course.
Of course.
Of course.
Hello, hey, how are you doing, sir? Good, good to see you.
Hey, Dan, how are you?
All right.
Now, coffee for you?
We were just talking about the coffee. This is awesome. Yes. Where's the hole? There it is. Oh, wow. Look at this. See, what?
I love it.
What did... So, I'm not going to lie.
Okay.
We had a discussion about you.
Okay.
It was the good, the bad, and the ugly of all that is Dan Roth. Okay, just so you know.
Bought in that third towel.
Yeah. So, and this is what we said, if I'm lying, I'm dying. I guarantee you, because we were guessing at your interior decor approach based on your personality.
Okay.
Look at this room.
I love it.
Yeah, I got to clean up the cables.
I mean, that is so stinking cool.
The standing desk.
Though. It's a powered standing desk, so I push a button and then I can sit down and...
Wow.
And then also, you know, me in America, I've got the Constitution up there, Declaration of Independence.
Yes.
No, what does Dan Roth's coffee maker coffee setup look like? So we've got to make sure we get this.
So there's a few areas. First, we have this setup here. This is a Breville Precision, which is great if I have a group of people here, can make a whole pot. It also does cold brew, which is great. And then I've got a Seiko Excelsis Express, which is a super automatic espresso machine, where if I grab a cup, put it in there. It's also a milk thing if I'm doing milk drinks, but I can go in, dial in my beverage, however I want, exactly how much, how hot, all that. I just push a button, it grinds it, it tamps it, and it brews it.
You're lying.
No.
Oh, I want that.
And if I did a milk drink, I just put a milk container, attach it to that, and that also steams and frosts the milk too. So I just push a button and I'm done.
Now, where does the roasting take place?
So this is my roaster.
Oh, wow.
Basically designed to make popcorn. But I have that. Infrared thermometer so I can gauge it. Flashlight so I can see through the smoke, overhead vent. I had to get this put in to do the roasting so it pumps the smoke out. And then somewhere over here I have a scale that I used to weigh it out. Right. Kim, what would you like? You want an Americano, a cappuccino, latte macchiato?
Yeah, how about latte macchiato?
Man, that sounds good. When it cools down, I want to sip.
Okay. Here we go.
Yeah, I have this weird metric I use to picking my neighborhood. One of the things I looked at in the neighborhood were how many American flags there are.
Mm.
It's a weird metric. I know there's not a lot of rhyme and reason to it, but I'm just like, I feel more home here. That's the best reason I can give you.
That's a good one.
We just sort of wanted you to take us through, the journey of your family and their... whatever particular theological and ecclesiastical perspectives that they had, mm-hmm. moving in through the different types of churches that you have moved through
from, you know, Methodist to Victory to the, you know, to the merger.
As long as I can remember, when, you know, far back, my family's always gone to church. We went to a Methodist church my entire time growing up. Yeah, it's right there. And it was just kind of one of those things. When I was younger, before I was saved, it was very much, you know, I went there because I had to. Like, my parents, that was just not a fight worth having. Right. So I'm just like, fine, I'll go, whatever. You know, I basically used science to explain the Bible and not the Bible to explain science,
right,
if that makes sense. So things like Noah's, the flood with Noah, that, like, I just would explain away. You know, it was probably really just this, but that's how it was interpreted, sort of thing.
Right.
And really just letting science define my world. But then I heard somebody put it very simply this way. Science is really just the scientific method, which is you have a question, you develop an experiment, you have a hypothesis, you run it. At its root, science is observable and repeatable and can only be done when you can control the variables.
Right.
How do you put together an experiment to prove the existence of God? If there is an all-powerful God, that is a variable you cannot control. So by its nature, science cannot tell us if there is a God, who that God is, or anything of that sort. So getting through, you know, wrestling through that whole thing, me getting into the Bible and everything, and basically I ended up learning to trust the Bible. Because in all the ways I could prove it, it was accurate. And a lot of times when I tell my testimony to people, I actually use you as an example. Because how many crazy things have happened to you, Brett? Like, just like, if some person told me this crazy thing happened to him, I'd be like, no, it didn't. But, like, as I got to know you in the early years, it was always somebody there to back up your story. So I'm like, holy smokes, this actually did happen to this guy.
Right.
And now I'm at a point where you could tell me that, you know, Abraham Lincoln visited you at night and told you this story, I'd be like, it probably happened. Because it's just, you've developed that trust with me.
Right.
And it's very much the same with the Bible. There are a lot of things in the Bible I cannot prove through historical record or anything.
Right.
Those are the things you have to take on faith. But the Bible had earned that trust with me.
Right. That's a great point.
And really, the church I grew up in, I'm not here to bash churches or anything, but it was very much, I can't think of a nicer way to say it, it was a Jesus-based social club.
Right.
Where you showed up, you met with some great people, you heard an encouraging message, and that was pretty much the bit.
Well, I'll have a small Diet Coke. And then...
A small regular Coke.
And then the largest Diet Coke you have.
Anything else?
No, that'll be it. Thank you.
Church business. We are hydrating our bassist.
Not our bassist.
Bass.
Our bassist. Hardly our...
That is one of those English things.
Yeah.
Where it's like, if you mishear somebody, you could be getting the completely wrong message.
That's right. When the Bible talks about looter people of the baser sort, it's not talking about the worship team.
Here's your moment.
This is it. This is a big moment. It's been a while.
There
you go. All right, you too.
It did not work. What is what? You had a regular?
Yeah.
Oh, you know what? This is from my old restaurant days. They say diet is darker. That might be Coke. If it's not. Is it regular or diet?
It's regular.
Okay.
It worked, Kim.
It worked.
The church I grew up in, it was very much kind of that social environment where... you'd go in, you'd sing a couple songs, hear an encouraging message, and, you know, for me, having gotten into the Bible is really getting convicted on the importance of just sharing the gospel.
Right.
And it was kind of interesting because I would bring this up to the people at the church and be like, yeah, that's a really good idea. Anyways, going back to business as usual.
Right.
Well, then went off to college, went to a actually a mega church for a short time there that actually started kind of showing me that things could be different. Very much preaching from the Word of God.
Really?
Which I was like, well, it was still very, very, you know, tailored, but the messages were based on the Word of God.
Oh, wow.
They did pick and choose, I believe. You know, they didn't do the fire and brimstone. But yeah, they did actually preach somewhat from the Word of God. I'm like, well, this is nice and different.
Right.
I'm like, who would have thunk at a church you read from God's Word? So that kind of gave me a little taste of it. And then come back home, and then my sister has found this new church through her then, I believe they were just dating at the time, Aaron Weens, and she's like, you need to check this out. I'm like, okay, but I will never forget that first Sunday at Victory. And you laugh, but holy smokes. It was from the Bible. You weren't injecting your opinion necessarily into, you know, the Word of God. You were letting the Word of God define the Word of God. And it was like coming across a fire hose in the desert. Because it was exactly what I wanted, but it was coming at me a million gallons a minute. But I'm like, yes, this!
Was our building renovated at the time?
It was mostly renovated.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
So it wasn't the bar.
It wasn't restaurant. The bar.
It wasn't the neon mermaids.
No neon mermaids.
Okay. No Miller High Life.
No Miller High Life.
Oh, okay. You missed it.
I did. I did miss that part. Right. I had heard stories, but I missed that part, which was part of the reason when Melanie told me about it. I'm like, really? But then eventually, you know, came on over. Very shortly after, merged with TBT, and some life stuff happened, and it made it a little hard for me to get involved dealing with some medical fun. My second Sunday that you were preaching at TBT, I was in like the fourth row, and you said, hey everyone, could you all move up a few rows? I'm like, okay, the pastor made, you know, a fair request.
Yes.
I can't object to it. So I stood up and I went up two rows. And then I sat down, and then I looked behind me.
Nobody
else moved.
You were the only one.
I'm like, what? Yes. I was so confused. So that's, for those that wonder why I sit in the front row, that's kind of a tip of the hat to that.
So, you know, we told you we did the good, the bad, and the ugly.
Yep.
Of Dan Roth.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? We discussed the fact that you are the perplexingly the only compliant Baptist possibly in the history of the Baptist church movement. Like, what is it about Baptists that they can be the kindest, the most godly, the most self-sacrificing? If you ask them to show up 5 minutes early or move to the center or front, you are going to have absolute defiance on your hand. Well, you know, they say not all that glitters is gold.
Mm-hmm.
Not all that is Baptist is beautiful.
That's fair.
The truth of the matter is, what you have found over the years is that there are Baptist false doctrines,
mm-hmm.
for sure.
Yep.
And there are Baptists' cultural hang-ups that even the ones who think, oh, they've broken free from all of that. They're the worst offenders.
Well, I guess, you know, in the big picture thing, if that's the sin that easily besets you, you're doing pretty good.
You're doing pretty good.
It could be worse.
It could be a lot worse. So, I think I figured it out.
Have you figured it out?
We're going to the old Victory Building.
We are indeed.
Yes.
Going to the old Victory Building. This is it.
Mm.
Victory Baptist Church, and there is our old house.
Yeah.
That's where we used to live.
So, really, there's two things I've really dealt with medically that have kind of been, you know, big things. The first was ulcerative colitis, which I was diagnosed in 08. And if you really wanted to, I could get in the story. That's how actually I got into specialty coffee. It was a really roundabout way because I learned that kind of what's more the commodity coffee, the cheap stuff,
right,
that causes it to flare up.
Oh, wow.
So, but that whole thing, basically, one day it felt like there was just a knife in my gut. Like, it was putting me on the floor. I couldn't move whenever it would kick in. And at the time, I was working as a substitute teacher. So, you know, they don't pay them six figures.
Right.
Or give them benefits or anything. So I was trying to figure out how to deal with this whole thing when really I didn't have that whole safety net. So I would have this feeling like a knife in my gut, and it was really painful. And dealing with it while being a substitute teacher and not having money really necessarily or a great health insurance plan to take care of it, it really kind of put me in a bind. And it was something that really caused me to question, am I where God wants me to be? Or is he using this to push me somewhere else? Or is he trying to teach me something through it? Really, I think those are the big things that if God's doing something in your life, those are usually the things that he's going for. So really, I think it was just kind of a lesson in patience. And because there are some things, you know, you'll have situations in your life that you don't know why, and they don't just disappear. You have to go through them for a while. And just the lessons that come with that, learning to trust in God, rely on God. And that was the big thing for me there. And then the whole cancer situation, I was diagnosed in 2010, I believe. That is I had some intense pain, and it was the point, again, I couldn't move or anything, different part of the body, and went to the doctor, and at first he was like, you know, okay, yeah, we caught it early, great, let's get it taken care of. But he wanted me to do one more scan before any sort of surgery or anything, and I went for that scan. Came back, and he was all cheery, but this guy had no poker face. All of a sudden, he's like, oh, crap. And I was on medication for the ulcerative colitis that made it so I needed to be off that for like a month before I could have any surgery. And the doc's like, no, we can't wait. We're doing it as soon as we can. Did that, had a couple rounds of chemo, and through all that, what God taught me is, you know, there's the old saying, count your blessings.
Yeah.
When you go through something like that, you don't need to count them. They'll count themselves for you.
Right.
Looking at the way the church was there for me, it's one of the reasons I love Wildwood.
Hmm.
I mean, you look at all the things that we have gone through in our church. Wow. I mean, you know, my cancer situation, Connor's, the Philbricks with their kids, and so on and so forth. I don't know of a lot of bodies that would step up to the same degree. And that includes bodies that are 2, 3, 4 times our size.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Because we have that level of, we want to be there for you.
Right.
And, you know, kind of coming full circle, that was the beautiful lesson I learned from Wildwood.
Mm. Some of the most profound things I've ever heard about cancer applied to the spiritual life have actually come from you and Kim.
And yeah, when you're in the middle of a trial or tribulation, you are just focused on getting through that and getting through that day and getting through that moment, getting through that whole trial. But definitely once you're through it, you're able to more fully realize how everybody supported you through it, how the body of Christ was there for you. You know, you feel it as you're going through it, and you feel that people are helping you, but like kind of once you're through that trial, then it really does hit you how vital it was, how it really did help you through probably one of the toughest times in your life, and you're just thankful for it. And then you realize, okay, how can I do that for somebody or the next person, you know, who's going through something tough like that?
You need family. You need empathy. You need people who have chewed the same dirt. Because there reaches a point where, like, I never wanted to say it, but there's almost this weird bond that comes from grief. Like, I don't even care if they're not saved. To this day, I hear of a parent whose kid has had cancer, and boom, there's a bond there.
Yep.
And I can immediately bond with them in a way that I cannot bond with anybody else when it comes to that. I'm not saying bond in life. When it comes to that, you're not going to manufacture that for me. And so when, now I feel the same way about Christ. When someone says, I'm a born-again believer, there should be that same, like, bond even greater. And then if you can fellowship in Christ, and then you can fellowship in Christ's sufferings, and then fellowship in my suffering, if one person can represent all of that, those people become the most supernaturally ordained people in my life to help me through my grief and my trial. And at the end of the day, if you don't run into those people, if you don't have those people and you don't have access to them, and you're really somehow missing a huge part of what God wants to do to bring healing into your life and to bring encouragement into your life.
Right.
And so it just so happens that, you know, there are very few people that I know that okay, I have fellowship in the person of Christ because I'm saved. I have fellowship in the sufferings of Christ because we have gone through some of the same, you know, mistreatments and some of the same mockery and some of the same ostracizations I'm sure some of the things that I have experienced out in the world are things you experienced at Western Michigan, and people are cruel, people are mean, and they feel this world gives them an excuse to treat Bible-believing Christians that way without compunction of conscience.
Mm-hmm.
And yet, you also had gone through cancer.
Yep.
And so, you know, just knowing that you were at church and the few things that you said really resonated with me, because when you can find all three of that, someone who can empathize with what you're going through in your physical despair, and yet they have fellowship in the gospel with you, man, that is, you can't buy that kind of help in any counseling session anywhere on the planet.
Well, now,
this really gets us to the most interesting part for some people.
Okay.
Because, you know, if you are a follower and fan of Christians and Cars Getting Cokes,
mm-hmm.
you know what comes next. I've got a river of life.
I do not know this one.
Oh, well, you got to learn this one.
Okay.
Okay, so, and we can teach you the motions.
Okay.
I've got a river of life flowing out of me. Makes the lame to walk and the blind to see. Opens prison's door, sets the captive free. I got a river of life flowing out of me. Spring up, oh well, goosh, 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 into my soul. Spring up, oh well, splish, splash, and make me whole. Spring up, oh well, woo, and give to me that life abundantly. I've got a river of life flowing out of me. Makes lame to walk and the blind to see. Opens prison's door, sets the captive free. I got a river of life flowing out of me. Spring up, oh well, goosh, 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 into my soul. Spring up, oh well, splish, splash, and make me whole. Spring up, oh well, woo, and give to me that life abundantly. All right. That was good.
Learned a new one.
You know what that was right there?
Hmm.
That was all in one song, the good, the bad, and the ugly of Wildwood Baptist Church. That was good intention.
Mm-hmm.
It was bad intonation and quality, and it was just simply an ugly sound.
Now, we were talking about on the way here, like, things that identify Dan Roth. I mean, like, what are, you know, like, coffee beans came up. I know, like, barbecue and Texas are things that you...
In Dan Roth's own opinion, what are the 10 adjectives that best encapsulate DR?
Someone who just wants to help out when they can.
That is absolutely true.
I mean, no matter how big or small, very chill, because I do not get, that's the one thing I do not mix well with, is people who cannot be chill. Like, you have to at least, you don't have to always be, but if you can't just sit back and Ferris Bueller for a hot second, it's a little
hard. I am loath to disagree with you.
Yeah?
If you don't mind.
Okay.
Begging your pardon.
Okay.
But we have a pretty good mojo going, and I am anything but chill.
Oh, you can chill.
I can?
You can. It's not your default setting, but I have seen you be chill. That's the thing.
He's capable.
Okay, all right.
That's the thing. You have to be able to. You don't always have to.
Okay, all right. Got it.
Always wanting to learn stuff.
Yes. Perpetually curious.
I mean, always digging into stuff.
What would you say, Kim? What would be your...
You know what? I would say that Dan is loyal. You know what I mean? Like, he's... For all the years that, you know, I've known you, like, you've never, I don't know, had a moment of discord, I don't think, you know? I mean, I think you are very, you're easygoing, and that you're loyal to something that you believe in.
Yes.
And you'll stand by your friends and your church family.
Mm-hmm.
And, yeah, you're just solid in that way.
I was going to say principled. What you will do for a principle and what you will refuse to move off of an iota on the basis of a principle for a principle's sake is I think quintessentially Dan. You have the Constitution and the Bill of Rights on your wall for a reason.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's not that you go around and try and, you know, show yourself to be this, you know, this constitutional lawyer that you could be. It's not that. It's just the idea that righteous principles and jurisprudence bring order and joy to lives is something that's a cause that you believe in.
Yeah. It's one of those things, really kind of getting into it with stuff that's happening today. You know, not to steal from Ben Parker, but with great freedom comes great responsibility.
Yes.
And it's something I think we have lost a little bit in this country. But again, I don't run around, you know, shouting at everyone like, hey, you're not supposed to do this or anything like that. I'm like, okay, you be an idiot and, you know, I'll be over here doing my thing. The people who are in my life who matter, unless they tell me to buzz off, I'm there.
Right.
Because, you know, kind of coming full circle. It's not why I did it, but it's kind of the benefit of that. Because then when things hit the fan for you, hopefully they'll be there for you. And, you know, there are people that, you know, I haven't seen or talked to in years, but still they can call me up. I'm there. All right.
Thanks, buddy.
Thank you.
Good times.
Mm-hmm.
Good times, good people.
Yep.
All right.
Good coffee. Oh,
yeah.
Dan, good coffee.
Dan, good coffee.
Dan Roth is good people. Good people, good coffee, good times. I had fun.
I had a great time.
This was a pleasant, sunshiny ride through Lambertville in Bedford, Michigan. This was what we had envisioned when we decided to have Christians
in cars
getting cokes. See you next week.